The real hip hop, MCing and DJing from your own mind, you know. I just right now we should start the show. Hey guys, and welcome to another episode of Media Talks TV. I'm Tony J, and if you're on Rumble, please subscribe. If you're on YouTube, click the like, hit the subscribe, and hit the notification bell for more videos. Okay, I want to dive into a topic that too few people understand, and that is the death of the public service announcement. Now, when I talk about media, I want people to understand that with media, the biggest issue that plagues media is that it doesn't have an informative arm anymore like it used to back then. And one of the things I've noticed, especially with the transformation of television, is most of the time there's nothing educational on television no more. Now, if you remember back in the 90s, television had a balance of informational content and entertainment content. And one of the things that television and broadcasting was responsible for was to air several public service announcements in between maybe every TV show in the early mornings and during the midnight. So with public service announcements now, you know, with the advent of social media and the rise of social media, you don't necessarily see a lot of public service announcements anymore because television has changed. Television is no more, is really not this controlled place that it once was. And television has now gone through, I would say, transformation after the 2000s because of social media. And people aren't around the television like they used to be when I was younger. So one of the things and one of the primary reasons I wanted to do this episode was because I feel as though media has to start somewhere, and I feel like analyzing the public service announcement might come off as being a little bit more relevant to my audience. And, you know, public service announcements used to be something that was really pro bono. It was something that was required by law to show 30 second PSAs in between Saturday morning cartoons and children's cartoons, because by law during that time there had to be educational informational content on TV. So with public service announcements, as some of you were a part of the 90s, you knew that the 90s were a time period of the anti-drug PSA. So that was the era. In the 80s, it was the environmental era. So you had mostly Smokey the Bear commercials that were being pushed onto audiences. And then in the 70s, it was, of course, anti-drug PSAs. And also, you know,
maybe late to mid 60s, maybe Anti-Smoking Cancer Association or Heart Association public service announcements during the late 60s, early 70s. I would say 1960, maybe 1971 was when you started to see a rise in the popularity of the public service announcement with Iron Eyes Cody, which has now most recently had a news story done about the 50th anniversary of that PSA and also the Smokey the Bear commercials, and also the Buckle Up for Safety, which was the seatbelt campaign that was released by the Ad Council in the late 70s. Well, not the late 70s, but the early 70s, late 60s, to encourage people to buckle up. The whole primary purpose of public service announcements was, of course, to get people a call to action to market a public cause, to get audiences rallied around a public cause or a social good, like voting, like picking up your trash, don't litter, don't recycle. So they had those types of PSAs in the early 70s. And then by the time we get to the 80s, we start to see the Ad Council focused on the anti-drug message that we all got when we were kids. So, they say, just say no. They'd have cartoon PSAs in between, stuff like G.I. Joe and the Smurfs. And, by the time we get to the 90s, it becomes a mandatory thing. It doesn't become a rarity that much in the 80s. It becomes now. By the time the 90s get here, it becomes a mandatory thing. Because of the Partnership for a Drug-Free America and also the Smokey the Bear commercials and McGruff the Crime Dog commercial and stuff about, anti-gun campaigns, anti-violence campaigns, getting out and vote, mostly. All for social causes and social good, and how to actually direct people to a social good and a social cause. There used to be a time in this nation's history where education and information were the key to a well-informed society. But since the rise of social media, you don't see that anymore. We've become mostly a less informed society or an ill-informed society. The origins of the public service announcements, if you really want to know what the origins are, you have to go back to Smokey the Bear. You have to go back to the Ad Council. Everything about a public service announcement really starts at World War II. And the Ad Council was a part of that. In World War II, the Ad Council got around this idea of selling war bonds and actually getting people to rally around supporting the war by buying war bonds. And then once that happens, the popularity of, okay, we can use radio, we can use the movie theaters to get people to rally around a social cause. So when the Ad Council was formed in the 1940s, you know, they came out with these small commercials, or, well, you wouldn't call them commercials back then, but they were airing the movie theaters between before the showing of a movie. So they'd be 10-minute snippets of, you know, why it's important for the American people to buy war bonds, why buying war bonds supports the war effort. And then you also had the campaign, once they did that, then you had the campaign called Loose Lips Sink Ships, or the slip of a lip could sink a ship. So it goes from that to making sure we protect troops abroad. So Ad Council becomes this arm of promoting the war effort. Then they come up with this idea about Smokey the Bear. And Smokey the Bear becomes mostly the face of the popularity that increases with the Advertising Council. So everything that we talk about here when it comes to public service announcements really starts with Smokey the Bear. And then environmental campaigns in the 70s, and then all of a sudden we have people like, you know, we have situations like the Partnership for a Drug-Free America, which is another video I'm going to do separate of this. And we're going to talk about another separate entity, because I really want to get into talking about the Partnership for a Drug-Free America, because it's one of the most important arms of public service announcements. And when you think about all of the public service announcements that have come out during the 90s, which is very well known, the Partnership for a Drug-Free America had government backing. It had money being put behind it in 1987. President Ronald Reagan put money into the anti-drug messaging and anti-drug education programs in schools, and the DARE program. And a lot of that kind of, you know, now we start to see by the late 80s, early 90s, seeing the public service announcement being an important entity of the media business, because it's pro bono work that helps to guide people around a social cause. In the next upcoming videos, I want to break down the history more, and we're going to look at some famous ads and what I like to call my separate segment, retrospectives, which is basically when we look back or we do a video reaction of certain public service announcements. And I'll be making another video on this topic, so we're going to, you know, look back on that. But before I go any further, just make sure you hit that like button. Make sure you subscribe to Media Talks TV. And, you know, make sure you're tuned in. And everything we talk about when it comes to public service announcements comes from the Ad Council. And the whole Ad Council, basically created by the 1960s, created this movement of really, I would say it created this idea of pro bono work in broadcasting, because television doesn't get its golden age until the 70s. Maybe you remember, some people older than me remember the anti-smoking ads from the American Cancer Society that John Wayne did. That would be a prime example of what a public service announcement is. And also most famous, maybe you remember this video, Yul Brynner in the American Cancer Society, and how he wanted to get people to stop smoking because he got cancer. And then by the 80s, we started to notice, ad council started to become this thing where, we could focus on other social goods, other behavior changes, not just, drugs and recycling. We could talk about, supporting the United Negro College Fund, which is another one. Another famous one that came out in 1972. Those types of donation causes, people going to the dentist or having an ad campaign to make people go to get regular checkups at the doctors. Stuff like that is what we call an informational campaign. And an informational campaign is basically, we create these ads, we create these commercials in between these shows to inform people about social issues and social problems harming the society at large, and we tell people what they need to do about it. And, as much as I like public service announcements, I know that public service announcements can also be harmful messaging. And we talk, and I talk about that more when we talk about the Partnership for a Drug-Free America, because some of those ads had a lot of hyperbole. And if you don't understand what hyperbole is, it's basically videos that have certain types of symbolic meanings to them, or metaphors about the consequences or the harmful effects of drugs. And a lot of this hyperbole was spouted throughout these anti-drug messaging that came out in the 90s. Some of it good, some of it completely bad. I could show you examples of that later on once we get into the discussion or into the issue about Partnership for a Drug-Free America. Because besides the Ad Council, Partnership for a Drug-Free America had government backing and billions of dollars put into their program, their anti-drug messaging. Yet, in some cases, they were profiting from alcohol and tobacco manufacturers. And it kind of went counterproductive to this anti-drug messaging that they wanted people to follow behind. But yet, most of their funding came from the government and also came from big tobacco and alcohol companies. So that's one of the issues that I find very troubling with the Partnership for a Drug-Free America. But on to the other note, in the next video, I'm going to talk about the Ad Council in more detail, and I'm also going to show you some videos, so make sure you stay tuned. And like I said, this is Media Talks. I'm your host, Tony J. Don't forget to like, subscribe, and share this video. Hit the notification bell. Thank you for tuning in. I'm Tony J. I'm out. The real.